February is Black History Month. But why? Where did Black History Month come from? It began with this man, Carter G. Woodson, a historian and writer. Woodson noticed that his people were, quote, overlooked, ignored, and even suppressed by the writers of history textbooks and the teachers who use them, end quote. So he started a Black History Week in 1926. And people celebrated it enthusiastically. They started Black History Clubs, and teachers started recognizing the contributions of Black Americans in their classrooms. He chose February, by the way, because it held the birthdays of both Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass, two men he believed had done tremendous work for the rights and liberties of African Americans. It took another 50 years, though, for Black History Month to become officially recognized by our government. The president at the time, Gerald Ford, said that we should seize the opportunity to honor the two often neglected accomplishments of Black Americans in every area of endeavor throughout our history. Here's the funny thing, though. Carter G. Woodson hoped that someday people would no longer celebrate Black History Month. He saw the day when it would no longer be necessary, when finally we would see Black history in America for what it really is, an essential part of American history.
In the victory, in the conquest, there's no turning back. Let freedom ring. Lift every voice and sing until the power comes.
Good morning. It's always a blessing to come back before you after coming before you from this channel. The numbers was a little different, but over 42 years, it's always a pleasure. And I want to thank Charlie Copeland and Ben Mobley of the Republican organization for allowing me the opportunity to continue to come before you. The month of February has been set aside for Black history. That's sort of strange that you would set up 1 month. I have the notion to continue to celebrate the whole year. Black history is such a large venture. The suffering and the agony that our foreparents went through that we might have the opportunities that we have today. No 1 month can justify being enough time to explain how we got here and how rugged the road was. On EdTV, we have set up for the month of February, since it's set aside, not just to do traditionally, but we are started a little bit late, so we're going to go into March presenting documentaries on Black history. I certainly want to thank the Patty Nash, the executive director of EdTV, and Rob, the director of the station, for joining me in the idea of not just celebrating the month, but to make sure that the community understand Black history. There are so many elements of Black history. A lot of us know about Dr. Martin Luther King and some of the other people whom we've heard about in conversation. But there are very few of us ever really sit down and look at documentaries and to get the real gist of what our foreparents went through. There was a lady that lives in the building that I lived in, Ingleside Apartments, and she is in her 80s. And I was talking with her about Black History Month. And she said, well, I got some history, Dr. Brown, that I'd like to talk with you about. I said, yes, what is it? She said, when I was a young girl, I had 6 sisters. And at 12 years old, we picked cotton together along with our mother for 5 cents a week. I said, sister, you're feeling all right? Do you realize what you're saying? She says, I want you to hear it again. My 5 sisters and I, and my mother, along with my mother, we picked cotton all week long for 5 cents. So I asked her, since we are interviewing different legends this month, would she be willing to do an interview? And she agreed. So this week we will be doing an interview with this lady. She now lives in an apartment where there's a lot of luxury there, air conditioned, 3 meals a day and all of this. And she was just sitting down talking with me, reflecting upon her life when she was young and what she went through with and what her parents went through with, that she could sit down now and look at flat screen TV and 3 meals a day, telephone, cell phone, and all these luxuries that we are enjoying. So we have our young people in the community who's getting in trouble and dropping out of school, not taking advantage of opportunities that's before them. So during the month of February, we invite you to tune in to EdTV. You can get EdTV on 2 networks, Comcast 965 and Verizon Channel 30. All during the month of February, you'll be able to see a schedule of the documentaries on Black history that we will be running. We want to thank all of the organizations who have helped us, the Newcastle County Library, the Historical Society, the Hagler Museum, who have supplied us with documentaries to run. And we want to thank those in the community whom we have done interviews with, who have given us very valuable information of Black history. I'll be joined this morning with a young man who wants to talk with me about my life history and the things that I have contributed to Black history. But a few days ago, last week, we had a group to come up to Wilmington from Delaware State University. A group of young people who wanted to participate in the Black History Celebration, what we were doing on Air TV. We were going to tape them, do the production at our studios at Remix Anderson, but we had some difficulties. So in as much as they were coming, we contacted Jay, the manager in charge here at Lease Access 28, and said, we're in trouble. We have some young people coming. We didn't want to disappoint them. They want us to come and do some poetry. And we want to thank him for opening the doors here. And those young people came, and we did the production. We're going to go now to one of those young ladies. And I want you to listen to the words that she's saying in this poem. Very thrilling, very mind-boggling, but it is the truth. We shall return in just a few moments, joined by our good friend, Brother Ben Mobley, after these messages.
Speak for me. Amen. May the work I've done speak for me. When I'm resting in my grave, there's nothing can say. May the work I've done speak for me.
Hi, my name is India Sage, and I'm a student at Delaware State University. I'm also the vice president of an organization entitled Spoken Word Artists United. And today I have written a poem entitled Iron Man. And this poem questions whether or not black man is relevant in today's society. And my poem says yes. Yes, you are relevant. Iron Man. I wish your body composition could have been created out of armor. More metal, less water, so there would be no confusion on who the real Iron Men are. See, I don't question the mixture of God's spit. But when I envision my little cousin being shot by police, bullets like missiles ripping through his skin like buttons off seams, it assured me, you don't need bulletproof vest. You need skin made of armor, indestructible mass of metal that protects your heart and allows it to keep beating. How could you survive without your iron shells? You need rib cages designed like barbed wire. Body cells in the shapes of prisms like the ones in prisons they won't let you out of. I wish your legacies began with the remembrance that you ascended from royalty. And when anyone referenced the crown, you thought of Mansa Musa before Massa. And when you heard the word kingdom, your domes would begin to sweat. And then, yes, maybe then you would walk around like king. At age 14, my little cousin asked me, well, what if the police start coming after me? At an age where he should be more concerned with playing with his friends and his toys, he was trying to figure out if heaven had a place for little boys. And in this society, it's no time to be a little boy when you have to be an Iron Man. I had to look him in his eyes of all his wrongs and rights and tell him to suit up and prepare for a war. He wasn't even prepared to fight. I had to tell him to suit up and prepare for a war. He wasn't even prepared to fight. And then later that night, watching the news to hear about bullets penetrating through flesh, piercing through divine skin, it was as if we were losing more martyrs than building men. Where was the fire that should have been cooking under us to realize that they possess assets that belong on the seats of thrones, not cells? And the very thoughts of their caskets should be more alarming than the enemy removing them from the streets that our ancestors paved. Bodies and blood now laying on the same pavement that our ancestors laid. Michael Brown bodies mixing with red wine. It's dinner time in these streets, and they're feasting off your futures to my Iron Men, who have not yet realized the lineage of those who you carry on your shoulders, a walking bibliography of soldiers. I say this from the pit of my stomach. Please hold your composure when you walk these streets unarmed. I could give you tips, like keep your arms by your side and don't move too quick to move inside your pockets to try to prove your innocence. Fumbling car keys, trying to show IDs and pleading with police. Please don't let your last 14 breaths be, I can't breathe. Don't let that slip out your lips as you're staring down a barrel of a gun. This unimaginable gift given to man that tries to play the idle hand of God, made out of the same metal I wish you were made of. Please don't try to run so they won't have a law-abiding reason to use their batons or their guns, made out of the same metal I wish you were made of. I can't protect you from this war, but I swear you're prepared to fight it. And the power is in your numbers and in your mind, so don't separate yourselves by your differences. That'll just make you blind. Don't move these books from your eyesight, because they probably conditioned you to believe that your ancestors couldn't read, and that's why you don't either. But if you want to save the existence of a black man in today's society, it starts with the first reader, the first Iron Man, the first leader, and I'm praying it's one of you.
And good morning and welcome back. I am Ben Mobley. Missed you for a while. Have not seen many of you over the last few months, obviously. You know, we've had a lot of things going on from an education standpoint, working towards master's degree, and you know, so that takes a lot of time and a lot of focus. So unfortunately, I have not been able to be with you over the last few months, but anytime that the subject of Black History Month comes up, I always look to take part in that, because obviously as an African American myself, I take great pride in the accomplishments of the people within our community, both past and present leaders. And I think it's really important to for the next generation to have some people that might be slightly a little bit younger get involved in the conversation when it comes to Black history. So many of us here have heard about you know, some of our past great leaders, such as Dr. Martin Luther King, you know, Malcolm X, Harriet Tubman. But my focus today is really all about our present leaders that, you know, are walking icons within our community that we may not, you know, consider when it comes to, you know, the great achievements of Black history within our community. So I am proud to be here today with the Reverend Twinbee Brown, because I consider Reverend Brown to be a pillar in this community and also an icon and someone who hopefully within, you know, our city walls, within our state walls, that, you know, as the years go by, he'll be one of those focuses that we talk about and that kids can write those little one-page reports that the teachers require to discuss some of the icons in Black history during Black History Month. So Reverend Brown, who literally I met a couple of years ago when I was campaigning for state insurance commissioner, you know, kind of pulled me to the side. And, you know, when I looked at his profile, and, you know, for any of us that, you know, have YouTube capabilities, please go to YouTube. There is a great profile, you know, of Dr. Twinbee Brown on there. Quite a few interviews where, you know, Dr. Brown is talking about, you know, education. He's talking about the least access television, our educational channel you can always catch Reverend Brown on. So I am pleased today to be able to interview him. And, you know, I guess my first question would always be, you know, how did you get started as a leader within the community? Because I think for many of us, you know, as we grow up, a lot of us don't take the bulls by the horn, tend to go into school, you know, do whatever it is that we do, start a career, you know, move on from there, and, you know, just become another member of the population. So I'm always intrigued by those who seek to have leadership and those who seek to, you know, reach out to government, to, you know, different community organizations for the benefit of our local city here. So, Reverend Brown, you have to tell me how you got your start here, you know, with Black history and, you know, with regards to some of the things that you've accomplished here within our community.
Well, I started in Florida, Daytona Beach, Florida, my hometown. At 9 years old, I was interested in always being a business person, and being in the church and around the church as a young man. And in my community, we had a lot of seniors. And so after Saturday, when I finished my chores around home for my grandmother, I was raised by my grandmother, I created a little business at 9 years old. I had a bicycle with a big crate on it, so I would go to the seniors, and we didn't have the malls and the shopping centers like we have today. We had the corner stores. Some seniors lived 3 or 4 blocks, and they would have to walk and get the groceries and all that. So, and seeing them pass by my house and walking with bags and all that, I'd say, well, maybe this is something that I can do and help them out. So I created a little business by going to the seniors on Saturday after I finished my chores and getting their lists and going to the corner store and sign for the food and take it back.
And did you charge them?
And at 9 years old, can you imagine 9 years old, at the end of the day, maybe servicing about 7 or 8 seniors. Well, some of them live 5 or 6 blocks from the store, so I had my bicycle. At the end of the day, I would end up sometime with maybe $30 or something like that, or $40 or something like that. But that was big money at 9 years old.
Do you know how many my grandmother used to tell me that? You could get so much for a nickel, like a hot dog, a soda.
Absolutely. I would go 4 blocks, get the food, and carry it back to them. I might get a quarter for doing that. But at the end of the day, so I created a little business and become an entrepreneur at 9 years old. And as I was in school, I always wanted to be a disc jockey. So I built a little platform in the backyard and practiced as though I was on the air. And in 10th grade, I went down to the radio station. And I asked the manager and the disc jockey, could I sit in the control room and just watch the disc jockey perform? So they let me do that. So I started hanging around the radio station, and I got there and they ended up getting keys where I would go there and get in the extra studio and practice and all. So one Sunday morning, I used to go before going to church. So this is how I got started into broadcasting. One Sunday morning, I would go down and I would do everything but talk on the air. I would spin the records and put them on the air and everything. Get up 6 o'clock on Sunday morning before going to church. So one Sunday morning, the owner called and said, they called me Benny. Said, Benny, Joey, who was the disc jockey, won't be able to come. He had an accident. So we want you to lock up the studio and go back home, and we'll see you again. We have to close down. He said, it's a shame we have to do this. So I said, but sir, you don't have to really close down. He said, well, what can we do? I said, sir, I can go on the air. He said, you can go on the air. What do you know about it? I said, well, I've been doing everything but talking for as long as I've been here. You know how to work everything? I said, yes, I'm got everything on now. We're just waiting for Joy. He said, well, I said, well, I have a problem doing it. He said, what problem? I said, this was a country western station. They had the hillbilly music.
Oh, wow.
I said, I can't play the hillbilly music and all that. He said, well, what you gonna do? I said, I have my own music. Yeah. You have your own music? I said, yes. And I have my own radio name, and I'm ready to go on there if you let me. He said, well, oh, I don't know, that's kind of different. So he decided after conversation, we're going to let you go on 30 minutes. My wife and I are going to listen, and if we don't like what we hear, we'll just let you lock up and go. So I went on the air, and I had, my name was the Gospel King, and I had my little piece together, and I had Aretha Franklin,
nice.
Precious Lord, a little 45, and a couple of them. So I went on the air, and after about 30 minutes, my friends started coming to the radio station from the community, although it was a hillbilly station, but all of the news and the church announcements that was on the station we had there was on there, so all the African-Americans listened on Sunday morning, especially. So I went on playing gospel and all that. So within an hour's time, the whole parking lot was full and people were coming to the radio station and all that. So I got my start, and we stayed on that morning. And from that morning on, they gave me my own program. I had my own hour program. And when I got in 12th grade, in the month of May before graduating, I convinced them to change over the format of the station to all African American programming.
Absolutely.
And WELE in Daytona Beach, Florida now is one of the most strongest stations in Central Florida, covers Sanford and Orlando and all that. It's still there now. But I was instrumental in getting that change from the hillbilly format to African American.
Nice.
And then I came up to Philadelphia. I was part of the Broadcasters Association with Louise Williams and all of them, and Joey Bishop and all of them. I knew them. So an opening came at WDAS in Philadelphia, and they needed a disc jockey. So I wanted to leave Florida. So I came up to there and worked there for 3 years. While in Philadelphia, I came over and met a young lady in Wilmington, and she kind of
opened. A lot of young ladies that kind of change our pathway.
She kind of opened my nose a little bit. So by coming over here, WILM was looking for an African American disc jockey who had their own records and could do a gospel program. So I was hired by WILM, and there for about 4 years. And while at WILM, Rollins Cable Vision went into the cable business in Wilmington and Newcastle County. They could not get African Americans to subscribe to cable. That was just another bill. And I'm just trying to be brief with this, but give you a little background. And so I was the popular guy in the community, emceeing the gospel programs and all of that. So John Rollins came to me and met with me and said we needed a person to be a liaison between the community and the cable company to get African Americans to buy cable. So he offered me more than I was making at WILM, so I went and started with the cable. And while trying to get African Americans to subscribe to cable, I convinced them to put a program on the air, and we did that. And about 7 or 8 years, and that took off, and they changed from public programming to lease access. So that's where the lease access is now. But it took about 8 years for the community to accept the idea of local TV. When we first introduced it, there were people who are on now, some of them or have been on, who fought against local programming during that time. It was a sell that did not work. But I scuffled with that, using my own furniture from home on Sunday. We had a one-camera studio in Newark, Delaware, in the corner of Ogletown and Chestnut Hill Road. So it built from there. Then it took off, and people started subscribing to cable, and it built from that point. So about 42 years we on, and up until 2 years ago, I was on the air. And certainly, I've done a lot. We did a lot of things, a lot of fundraisers, and so many things over the years. So briefly, that's where it is. But I have my profile of my contributions to Black history will be found on the internet at cccmediatv1.org, community update. If there's anybody who would like to know or follow my life history, which I'm very proud today to be able to sit here after over 70 years of service starting in Florida, to be able to sit here and talk with you this morning. And I want to thank you for wanting to interview me. And just let me right now thank Jay and the staff here at Channel 28.
Absolutely.
After finding out that you was going to come to interview me, Jay wanted to come here this morning and do something special. And I certainly want to thank
you,
him. When Jay first came to the organization, I was here. We've been working together for years, and certainly for him to come this morning and to want to do this special because you're interviewing me, I certainly want to thank him. I can't thank him enough for
that.
And so that's just briefly about some of the things.
Okay? We're going to take a commercial break, but when we come back, you know, Reverend Brown talked about some of the profiles, you know, some of the accomplishments that he's had that are listed on the internet. I know Reverend Brown to be a very humble man. So therefore, you know, my job over the next 15 minutes is to get him to start talking about some of the accomplishments that he's had in the community, because I really think it's something that our youth and many of the people that are coming into, you know, the city of Wilmington can really benefit a lot by knowing who the movers and shakers are within our community. So we're going to go to a commercial break, and right before we do, if you go to YouTube, you can go to, you know, Dr. Twin B. Brown's profile on there. Twin B. Brown has a workshop success item on there as well. And again, that email address, actually that website address, I need to get used to the new age, is www.cccmediatv1.org. We'll be back.
Until the power comes down.
How can we expect one to participate when they don't know what's going on? Each year we dedicate 1 month to Black history, but who actually knows their native history? EdTV and the CCC Coalition of Producers invite you to join them throughout the whole month of February, learning about Dr. Martin Luther King and the ancestors. Tune into EdTV for upcoming times and subjects as we air documentaries and local presentations on Black history. We urge grandparents and grandchildren to gather around Comcast Channel 965 and Verizon Channel 20 as we help educate the community on the Black history.
Glory is in the words, in the beat, in the melody, in the joy, in the victory, in the conquest. There's no turning back. Let freedom ring. Lift every voice and sing until the power comes down. Let the power come down.
Welcome back. I am Ben Mobley, co-hosting with my Black History Month icon, the Reverend Twin B. Brown. And during a commercial break, I also ate some spinach and drank some milk, so you will notice I'm a little bit taller. Thank you so much. But we're back. And as I stated, you know, in our last session, that Black History Month should mean so much to me, obviously. It's all about the leadership, our past and present, and I really want to keep the focus on our present leadership. I think we all know the stories, for the most part, about you know, our past leaders that have, you know, come and helped us to progress to where we are today, but I really want to get focused on our present leadership. And with me here today is the Reverend Twin B. Brown, who I consider to be just a walking lineage of history. During our last session, he talked about his humble beginnings, why he moved from nice, warm Florida up to cold and frigid Wilmington, Delaware. But he mentioned a lot about his profiles and his success, and I really want to get into that so that we have a clear understanding of, you know, some of the things that Reverend Brown has done within our community that I think should be something that we should all know, especially here within the city of Wilmington. So Reverend Brown, if you will, I want you to talk about some of the things and programs that you've accomplished that have really benefited our city here in Wilmington.
Well, we have, there's many things, but some of the things we need to highlight is voter registration. We promoted voter registration. I conducted the largest voter registration drive in the history of Wilmington, Newcastle County. And that was leading up to the election of our first African-American mayor, Mayor Jim Sears. We rallied people around voter registration. The turnout was tremendous. And he have a piece that's on the internet now where he said if it wasn't for that voter registration that we conducted with the help of the community,
Absolutely.
He probably would have never been the first African American mayor. We did telethons to help people, the needy. Christmas and Thanksgiving time, the turkey drive that's conducted now by my good brother Stormy Norman. That was something that we did. I took that over from a lady named Mom Macy. Christmas, she used to cook dinners for the homeless at a house there on Church Street. And she asked me to join and help her out, so I did. So when she passed away, I continued to do the turkey drive. And we used to cook dinners and serve dinners to all of the seniors in the high rises and have people, the homeless, to come in. We did it at different places, but our main post was Bancroft School. We used Bancroft School because they have a very large facility there to cook. So we had three shifts. We would have people to come in 5 o'clock in the morning, one shift. They would leave maybe 10 in the day, and another shift come in and during the day. We would work 400 volunteers. Wow. On Christmas Day, and that we were serving dinners, and we had a Congo, semi-Congo had a shell service, and we used to have the shell service to deliver the dinners, and we had volunteers in the community that would go into the high rises and actually go up on the elevators and deliver the dinners to the different seniors. Awesome. In the high rises. So we did that for many years, but it got to the point where it was very tiresome, and people was working, and an 89-year-old lady named Mrs. Turner, she said to me, she says, I got a better idea, Dr. Brown, for your turkey giveaway and your turkey dinners. And I said, well, what is it? She says, okay, you give away dinners, they're beautiful dinners, they're good dinners. She said, but at the end of the day, we've eaten that dinner, and everything is gone. She said, why don't you give us a big turkey?
Yeah.
And if we would take that turkey, we can get some collard greens and beans and all of that. And instead of eating one day, we could eat the whole week with that turkey. We get down to the bone, we could make turkey
Absolutely.
Soup. So we changed and started giving away turkeys. So for 37 years, we conducted the turkey giveaway and the turkey dinner combined in the city until a few years ago. It was taken over by Stormy Norman. That was one of the big things. And we had people to join in. We had the late Jim Gilliam Jr., who used to work in the kitchen with his whole family. People would come with whole families and work. It was one thing about that turkey drive during that time. People would come together on
Absolutely.
Christmas Day, children, adults from all race, white, black, Hispanics and all, and work together. So that was something that was very dear to my heart. But during the creation of Lease Access, I have always, and people remind me of this today, I've always preached the need for a public and an educational channel. Because in creating the Lease Access Channel, I knew then, and we knew then, that only certain people would be able to utilize this channel because you had to pay. And the average citizen did not have money to buy time on Lease Access. So the schools and the children and the local agencies wouldn't have an opportunity to be heard. So I've always preached. So for years, and people would say, I'm trying to get rid of Lease Access. They was trying to feel that if I was crying for a public and education, so that went on, which was not true, but the mentality of people brought that on. So, but as Norm Griffin decided he was not going to stay in office as president of city council, and I had, along with Councilwoman Hanitha Sabaz, been hollering about trying to get an education in the public channel. He decided to put it up for contract. So now with the Red Clay School District and Comcast in the city of Wilmington, we have an educational channel
Absolutely.
On the air now.
What are some of the programs that people can see on that education?
Well, anything that not only is it an educational channel, but I convinced Patty Nash, the executive director, and Norm, the superintendent, to also include community programming as long as there is an educational component in it.
Exactly.
It's an educational channel, but accept community activities as long as there's an education component in it. So in as much as I convinced them, along with Councilwoman Hanitha Sabaz, to put it on the air, I came back from working in Baltimore 2 years to conduct the workshop to make sure that the community take the advantage of it and the other school district. So that's what I've been doing for the last couple of years.
And have you seen a positive response come back from the community with regards to?
Yes, the it's going well. As you can remember now, when we started lease access, it was not lease access, it was public access.
Absolutely.
Because for about 8 years, we used that to get African Americans to buy cable. But
exactly.
Once they started subscribing to cable, then it changed to lease access. Now, the educational channel has only been on the air for 2 years now. It's into the third year. And if you're going to compare that to the struggles that we had trying to get lease access started, we're doing very well with
Absolutely.
It. So Black History Month, and I was always thinking of a way how to promote the channel, but still how to educate the community.
There you go.
So through prayer, the Lord gave it to me to not just announce Black History Month and go along with the trend of it, but make sure that the community, our young people and our young parents understand what Black history is all about, understand the struggles that our foreparents went through, that they might have the privilege they have today, and a lot of them are not taking advantage of that. So during the month, the whole month, we are doing documentaries on the educational channel. We were late getting started because it's hard to do that because the educational channel does not have live programming. Everything has to be produced.
Absolutely.
So everything we put on has to be produced. We have some producers out there, but we were short of funding. It's hard to get people to do things for nothing.
Absolutely.
And then producing things. So we were a little behind in that, but since we started late, we're going to go into March, also continuing to present documentaries on Black history. And we have people that's working with us, like the Newcastle County Library, the Hagler Museum, the Historical Society, all of them have been very, very good working with us and supplying documentaries. So that's what we're doing right now. But not only are we presenting the documentary, we want our grandparents to sit down with their children, who are the parents of some of our teenagers,
Absolutely.
That everybody might understand what it means to celebrate Black history.
And I'm in total agreement, with that vision. You know, I've often said it, you know, everything starts in the home. The family is really the place to where, you know, when you look at where a kid goes or doesn't go, that's really the launching pad for future success. And as someone who, you know, learned heavily about Black history, you know, growing up, I am one who, much like yourself, I look at some of the struggles that our prior generations went through.
Yes.
And I say to myself, there's no excuse for me not to be able to succeed in this country in this lifetime. Because different from today versus yesterday is that many of you're going to have people that are going to be racist, you know, on both sides, all over the place.
Yes.
But as long as the racism isn't institutionalized, preventing me from going into certain careers, certain places, certain institutions, then at that point, it's all about competition. And it's about us doing our part to make sure that we do everything within our abilities to become a success. So we are going to take a commercial break. We're going to come right back again and talk with the Reverend Brown. We're going to continue on to what he's discussing as far as his new battles with regards to the educational channel.
Yes.
Some of the things that he's working on looking forward. I want to ask a poignant question, which is I want to know who Reverend Brown looks up to, who's his key figure as far as Black history. So again, you can catch the Reverend Brown on YouTube, Dr. Twinbee Brown. He has his profile, also his workshop success, as well as a little bio on Twin Brown, all on YouTube, or you can go to the website, www.cccmediatv1, the number one, www.blackhistorymonth.org. Benjamin Mobley, joined by the Reverend Twimby Brown, and what we're talking about here today is Black History Month. So obviously there are so many key figures that we can look back to that have inspired future generations. I know for me, you know, I was a big Booker T. Washington fan, you know, growing up. I thought that his ideals with regards to success, business ownership, and education were key to my success. So often whenever I speak with someone with the Reverend Brown's resume, I often want to know, who did he look up to, you know, as he was growing up? Who was his key figure where he said, you know what, I like that guy or gal, and this kind of helped to inspire my vision. So Reverend Brown, question for you, who's your key figure?
Well, in my hometown, is known for Bethune-Cookman College. Is a college that was founded by an African-American woman with five girls.
Yes.
Started with fruit crates and all. They didn't have seats and all that, so she started that institution in my hometown. And Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, as a little boy, I used to clean her yard when I had a little thing cleaning yards and cutting yards. And one day I got up enough nerve to ask the people who worked for her to clean the yard. So I climbed to clean the yard, and that's how I got a chance to meet Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune.
Wow.
And after finishing high school, I went to Bethune-Cookman. And after Bethune-Cookman, I went to vocational school there in Daytona. So she was my aisle. We were scared of her because she was a heavyset lady. And,
if
she said something, you know, we was all afraid. But it was just an honor to go to the same school where a lady with five girls started an institution. I went back home after being up here a couple of times, and the city of Daytona Beach, Florida have changed so until I didn't hardly know my way around. I was born there, worked there, grew up there, played football, basketball, and all that. But when you stay away a while, the way things is now, they can almost change a whole community.
Absolutely.
Around the new homes and all that. Even the school now is a university.
Absolutely.
Instead of a college. So she was mild, and it gave me a lot of inspiration, just the history of the school, and for me to have the honor to go there after growing up is something dear to my heart.
Absolutely, absolutely. Looking forward, I know, you know, we're obviously working on the educational channel, but what would you want to say to the youth today and some of the grandparents watching with regards to Black History Month, the importance of it, and some ways in which we can kind of redefine, you know, this next generation towards success?
The promo that we have been running says, how can we expect people to participate when they don't know what's going on? Well, that's my idea of present the special on the educational channel. We talk about celebrating Black History Month, but how are you going to celebrate something if you don't know Black history? So Absolutely. So that is the trend about it all. So we want everyone to go to EdTV, Comcast 965, and those in the community, and especially in the county, who have Verizon Channel 30, and you'll be able, during the rest of the month of February and into the month of March, to view documentaries on Black history.
Absolutely, absolutely. And in this last 30 seconds, let me just thank you for giving me the opportunity to interview you. You know, you and I have talked much since the election, So, you know, it is a pleasure to, you know, have this privilege to review. And for those of you, again, if you could please go to www.cccmediatv1.org. You can find out all about the Reverend Brown and what he's doing within the communities for our benefit. So we want to take you now, and we've been talking about Black history. We want to take you now to a nice video that talks about the history of Black history. I'm Ben Mobley. This is the Reverend Twinbee Brown. God bless you today.
I cannot help.
Honored to be able to read the numerous proclamations from all levels of government that we've been blessed with this evening. But we want to start with our president of City Council, Councilman Norman Griffin, to read a proclamation of City Council.
Thank you, Councilwoman Shabazz. Council sponsors resolutions to honor people quite a bit, and that's because so many folks in Wilmington are doing great things out in the community. Some, like Dr. Brown, are doing it without a lot of fanfare, and a lot of times only those that are really benefiting understand exactly what he's contributed to the community. I can't tell you how much of a help he's been to me with learning the background of leased access. As you know, the city council is in the midst of negotiations with Comcast on a renewed cable franchise agreement, and a big part of that negotiation has been retention of live leased access. Because I'm in the room, actually face-to-face with the Comcast representatives, it was very important for me to understand the background of live leased access and its importance to the city. As former Councilman Guy mentioned when he was speaking, Wilmington is unique in having live leased access. And Reverend Brown is the one that actually started it and provided a tremendous amount of background for me to help with the negotiations. We're not there yet with Comcast, but hopefully we'll have an agreement that will serve a lot of different interests in reference to how you watch television in the city of Wilmington. But nevertheless, there's no doubt that live leased access will continue. That's going to be a part of the renewal agreement. Thank you. I'd like to read a resolution. Since Councilwoman Shabazz has several others to read, I'll read this one from City Council, and it is from all members of City Council. And I'd just like to state the names of all of our members for the 105th session. As Councilwoman Shabazz said, my name is Norman Griffiths. I'm the president. Councilmember Charles Potter represents the 1st District. Councilman Ernest Trippy Congo, the 2nd, represents the 2nd District, my old district. Eric D. Robinson is the 3rd District Council person. Hanifa Shabazz represents the 4th Council District. Samuel Prado, the 5th. Kevin Kelly, the 6th. Paul Ignuto, the 7th. Stephen Martelli, the 8th. Michael A. Brown is at large. Charles M. Bud Friel is at large. Loretta Walsh is at large. And Justin Wright is at large. Whereas Wilmington City Council wishes to recognize the outreach work the Reverend Benjamin Twinbee Brown is providing through the video production hands-on workshop and production company. And whereas, though a native of Daytona Beach, Florida, Reverend Brown is an adopted Wilmingtonian, he immediately made his mark in down-home charm. He owned and operated a successful electronic sales and repair business. He invested and promoted spiritual programs that involve youth and his signature video production company, which he founded over 33 years ago to give youth hands-on experience in production and the opportunity for them to showcase their talents on stage and on television. His shows are also a vehicle that brings local news and events to the Newcastle County communities. And whereas Reverend Brown attributes his success to God for giving him the vision that opened doors of opportunity for him, his youth participants and staff, his testimony can be summed up in Psalm 27, chapters 13 and 14. I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Now therefore be it resolved by the council of the city of Wilmington that this council recognizes Reverend Benjamin Twinbee Brown for making a difference in the lives of Delawareans. God bless you for a job well done.
And as you heard President Griffin acknowledge the great importance and value that Servant Twinbee Brown has given to us for Live Leaf Access, there's also another major achievement that we will be blessed with through his continuous efforts. And I passed an ordinance supported by City Council to activate the educational channel. Wilmington will have a channel that will be dedicated to educating our young people and educating our community. This has been a quest that Reverend Brown put on my heart a long time ago. We talked about this many, many years ago. And then as I got blessed to be in a position and power to be able to do something about it, I want to thank you for putting that on me, that vision into me, and God blessing to me and the support of council that we now will have not just the Live Leaf Access, but we also have a government channel, which is Channel 22. We encourage you to look at that because it's important information about the function of the city. But we will soon have an educational channel that would educate our community, our children, and our families. Thank you, everybody. I also have resolution tribute and recognition of Benjamin Twinbee Brown. I won't read all of it because it would keep us here all night, and I know you want to hear more tributes to you, but just to let you know that the from the office of the county executive, from Paul Clark, has presented you with the proclamation to representatives for his 55 years in broadcasting Comcast Channel 28, Spiritual Revival Hour. Special recognition from State Representative Stephanie T. Bolden. And also from State Senator Margaret Rose. We also have a proclamation from her. And from the Office of the Governor, who hereby known to all of the Jack Markell and his Lieutenant Governor, Matthew Dinn, to Reverend Twinbee Brown for your outstanding service to the community. I present this resolution also to you. And we also have a special presentation from the governor for you, Reverend Brown.
Hi, I'm Delaware Governor Jack Markell, and I am delighted to add my voice of tribute and congratulations to Twinbee Brown. Twin is a legend in Delaware and certainly the cable access community beyond Delaware. He has trained generations of young people in media production, professional interviewing, and the like. I don't know that there really is anybody in Newcastle County who doesn't know about Twinbee or who hasn't watched some of his great productions. I am just really proud to be a Twinbee supporter. And Twin, keep it going.